So this is week 9. Last week we discussed heating, and this week we'll discuss cooling. What do we mean by that? We have two different types of cooling and heating loads. So in general, heating load is we estimate how much heat we have to add into the house in the winter. And for cooling, we try to estimate and calculate how much heat we have to remove from the house to the outside. So if you think about it from heat transfer point of view, it should be the same because we have the same boundaries, which is actually true. It is the same. However, the only thing that will change is work. This is our heat transfer load for Q transfer transmission. What are the two types of heating loss in a house?
Infiltration and transmission.
Yeah. Infiltration transmission. For transmission, area times U times delta T. And here, volume times N times delta T. So if you think about T, what do you think will change? The only thing that will change in those two equations is the temperature difference. For the cooling, we will consider inside temperature. Outside hottest day of the year.
It's like 100.
Yeah, could be more. And for heating, inside temperature. The equations are the same. There are actually few differences. That's concerning temperature. What about humidity? Humidity also adds the cooling load because in the summertime is more humid than the wintertime. You agree? Mm-hmm. And what is the humidity range? We want it to be from 40 to 60. I'll write that down. The human comfort level. So in the summertime, we can go down to 60. It's more humid in the summer than in the winter. In the winter, it becomes very, very dry. So we have to add humidity. Adding humidity does not affect our heating load, but removing humidity affects the cooling load. Why is that? Because your AC will work into transferring the vapor in the air into water. So some of your cooling load will be spent on drying there before it starts to feel cooler. And that's what kind of heat? Latent heat, not sensible heat. Meanwhile, we are looking for sensible heat in the house. So the humidity does affect your cooling load.
And humidity is called your wet bulb when you're measuring temperature?
Yeah, wet bulb is, there's the wet bulb temperature and the dew temperature. Dew temperature is when it starts to condensate, and the wet bulb temperature is when the water starts to evaporate. At the temperature when we start to have evaporation. And usually it's using a slingshot, sling psychrometer. She put a little piece of wet cotton, and it started like evaporating, and see what is the temperature. So these are the cooling and heating differences, the little temperature and the humidity. Heat gain is a little bit trickier than heat load. I mean heat loss. Heat loss, you're losing heat mostly through transmission and infiltration. Heat gain has a lot of, it plays a big role when it comes to windows and doors and also the color. So that will affect your heat gain. Why do most roofs are dark colors or black? Because you're trying to use the sun rays, even in the winter, to melt the snow out of your roof. Reflectivity, we will talk about reflectivity and what does it mean. In the summertime, this will become a very major role player in cooling loads. If your house is reflective, it's not absorbing as much heat. If it absorbs much heat, then it will be very difficult for you to heat it up, I mean to cool it down. So reflectivity, and it's also based on colors. So brighter colors reflect more heat. Mirror is the best, so they completely reflect everything. That'll be the best to reflect heat. Some windows actually, maybe you have some sunglasses that are sun reactive. If it's too much sun, it will start shading. So there are some ways where you can have paint that reacts to the heat differently and
become more reflective.
Yeah. It's funny how the human skin is different. The more sun it is, the more it's getting tan. And that's the idea is the melanin in your skin will prevent the sun rays to go through to your body. So if you want to have a shade that will block the light, you're not gonna go with light color. If you have white shades or white curtains, the light will go right through. Darker color will absorb more light. So you have if you have black curtain or blackout, it completely blocks everything. That's why your skin gets darker when you go into the sun, because it's trying to prevent too much sun rays getting into your body. So we can learn a lot from nature. Also, trees with darker leaves usually are located in places where there's too much sun. You notice that? If you go to tropical trees, usually they have dark leaves because trying to absorb less sun. Brighter leaves mean usually is available in brighter areas. If you look at conifers or pine, it's very, very dark color. Very dark color because it's trying to absorb as much sun as it can in the winter. And you see all the light leaves colors, they fall in the right now actually, because it's time to adjust to having less sun and more temperature. Actually, it's a funny factoid that most trees that lives in the northern area, like probably New England and Canada, they use all the sugars in the maple syrup, all the sugar in the tree, to transfer into something like antifreeze. And it will lose all the leaves and store all this antifreeze in the trunk and the branches. And that antifreeze actually act like antifreeze. It does not freeze, it's not solidified. If you have tropical trees here where they have more water-based liquid inside them, they will freeze and die. And it will never come back again. But some trees adapted to changing that to sugary mix that have freezing temperature. We'll talk about landscaping. And I said Friday I'll have a guest lecturer from the landscaping department to talk to you a little bit about what is the role of landscaping to cooling. And you'll be surprised how much it plays in your cooling load. Probably if you have a house that's well located in the right direction, you will shade it, you wouldn't even need the ACs. You can cool cool your entire house with using just natural draft. And I said in the beginning of the semester, there are a few houses here that call completely passive cooling and passive heating in New England. Actually, there's few in Westfield that you do not need an AC and you do not need any heating, just based on the house design and the material. During the sun, during hot times, the material will absorb a lot of heat and release it slowly during the night. So it's between storage and between also how exposed are you to the elements, to wind and ventilation, and also locations. I mean, a lot of animals live here without heating and cooling, so, and there are mammals too, so they can manage. So the Native American lived here for a long time without heating and cooling. Or maybe with a small amount of heating and cooling, and they managed. So you can without it burning a lot of coal or wood or whatever. Awning, how does awning contribute to the cooling load? What is awning?
It's like a big cover. Like,
yeah,
a,
it's
like
kind of an umbrella
like
cover.
Roof.
It's a fixture that comes. It's not part of the window, but it's in top of the window. And this actually was a question on the heat load analyst exam. What is awning? Is it part of the window? Is it a window? Or is it just a shade that reflects in the window? In terms of trying to divert all the sun rays, this is one of the best ways, because you provide a complete shade into the window, so you're not getting any sun heat into your house, and you're still getting the view. So what is the point of having a window if you have to block it in the sun? That's really defy the purpose. And you want to open the window in the summertime and get some cool breeze coming in. Most of the cool breeze come from the bottom or the top?
Bottom.
From the bottom, from the ground. That's the cool where the cold air is, and that's where you have a lot of water and moisture. That's evaporating. And when things evaporate, what do they take with them?
Heat.
In some places in Africa, when it gets too hot and dry, they will wet a big sheet and hang it in the window. And that will cool your entire room just by evaporating. It's very ingenious and a very cheap way to cool your place. Or if one day you was trying in a desert, get a sheet, and you can connect the sheet to a bucket or something, so you have a big bucket of water being evaporated all night.
Yeah, it'll pull the water
yeah,
out
it'll
of
pull
the
water
into the fabric.
Yeah, and you'll have cooling for free. And what is the name of the desert in Chile? Anyway, there is one of the biggest deserts in the world is in Chile, and it has no rain, zero rain, ever. However, all the plants there collect water from from the air. So the villagers there, what do? They have a mesh, it's kind of like the screen mesh you have in your window. And the mesh is made out of metal. Metal have good conductivity, it will lose heat quickly. So the mesh is spread out, and the little particles of water will collect in the mesh and drip into buckets overnight. When the temperature is down, the air coming from the ocean, loaded with moisture, it will drip down and you have water streams. So small ideas like that can do a lot of cooling. And you can use that for cooling your house with least amount of power required. However, the temperature has been increased. I mean, they say the temperature has been increased by 3 degrees in the last decade or so. You probably will need an AC at some point, especially if your house is not well designed. But I truly believe that if your house is well designed, especially in New England, you will not need air conditioning. I don't know, but I know a lot of people who lived all their lives here without air conditioning, if you're in the right location. And, okay, so cooling versus heating. Cooling is very variable. So they say like two houses in the same neighborhood might have different cooling bill, depending on how much insulation they have, the window sizes, window locations, amount of trees around them, how they face the window, and how they face the sun. Same neighborhood, two people paying 3 times more than others just because of the house orientation. Do you have window shades? You don't have window shades. Your AC will burn 24/7. If you're facing south and east, probably you'll have a lot of sun all the time. And if you that, if it happens to have, if you happen to have a lot of windows there that are not double glass and they have, they do not have low emissivity, probably you'll be losing a lot of money cooling your house. So few things you can do to mitigate that. Installing shades is an idea. Installing awning will make a big difference. If you notice in the summertime, it will be very, very hot, but you go in the shade and it's completely different.
Mm-hmm.
So the sun is very, big factor into heating your body. Being in the shade is much different than being in the sun. That's why if you see people in North Africa, you'll wonder how come they're not wearing shorts and sleeveless shirts. They wear all those big, flowy clothing. That's why. Because if you block the sun rays, you're going to be cool. And you permit more like, airflow to your body. So you see the Maasai's or the Bushmen always wearing like, big clothes, flowy clothes. And it's not a good idea to have shorts because the sun will be baking your skin. You want to block the sun first. So it makes sense. So that's why I really wonder when I see people in the sun with shorts and tank tops. Okay, that doesn't make sense. The sun is still baking your skin. But you have to put on, again, sunscreen. But you're still getting a lot of heat, even with sunscreen. So different by factor of 50 times more, your house in the same location. That's huge. Factor 50 between two houses in the same location. So 50 times more. Bless you.
Nice.
Shades of the trees. I said the shade of a tree is 20 degrees cooler than the shade of a wall because trees evaporate moisture through their leaves and grass and make things a little bit cooler. Nighttime ventilation, it's a very key element.
So my parents open their windows at night and then close everything during the day, and it's like it's so much cooler
in
the house.
If you want to cool your house really properly, and you have a two-story house, you open the windows in the first floor, and you go to the highest area point in your house and put a vent in there, or just open a vent, and even to put a power vent. The natural convection will just completely cool your house. It will be at least like 65, which is very comfortable. Window glass and the solar heat gain factor coefficient, we talked about that in the windows. So glass, even though it could be double glass, it's vacuumed, but sun rays and radiation goes through vacuum. So you're still going to get a lot of heat through the double glass. So how do you counteract that? You have to put some films on the glass to block the UV rays, or you have to put some awning or some shade. You can provide shade for your window. Otherwise, it will heat your house very, very quickly. If you have a door as big as this one, like 4x7, and it's completely glass and facing south, that will heat your house rapidly in the summertime. And another thing, if you have an attic, and the attic is not ventilated, and what color is usually the shingles, very dark color, because they help in melting the snow, this attic will be at least 150 in the summertime. It's going to be hot. It will absorb a lot of heat through the roof, even though it's wood. Even if it's a little bit insulated, you still have some heat. It will accumulate a lot of heat, and because it's not vented, it will stay in there. So it will be a wise idea to have a vent in the summer open for the attic just to circulate. Otherwise, your roof is going to be at 120, 110, which is a lot. And your AC is working to keep up, but it's not happening. Low humidity help cooling, but not heating. So if you have humidity, that will help in cooling because as it evaporates, it will take some heat. And again, we said like a lot of ACs work much better if you put them in the dehumidification mode, because in that sense, they are bleeding water more than they're supposed to. And that will make them extract more heat out of the room. So if you put the AC on just AC mode with no dehumidification, probably you have to plug the water line. It will not require a water line. And you're slowly, again, still making some water, but you're taking that water to the exit vent to evaporate to the outside, which is not as effective as condensing the water, taking the heat out, and pouring that outside. So it's better to put it in the dehumidification mode. If you have an AC and you want to work much better, then really good. So, and again, remember when people say, oh yeah, Arizona is dry heat, it's better than humid heat. Heat is heat. It's hot, it's hot. However, if you have dry heat, what is the advantage?
Easier to cool, yeah.
Yeah, why?
You don't have to remove the moisture.
Yeah, huh?
You don't have to remove the moisture from the air.
That's true. But why? So until 80 degrees Fahrenheit, the body, the human body, do not need to perspire. No perspiration, no sweat.
Yeah, right.
It can regulate, depending on your body. Just based on this area of the skin, we can do heat transfer using just convection, and we'll be fine. We can manage our guys. Not me, I need at least like 65. After 80, you start to sweat. Your body starts to sweat because it wants to cool off. If it's very humid, your sweat's gonna stay there, providing extra layer of insulation, and it's not serving the purpose. If it's very dry, the sweat will evaporate quickly, because the air will carry more moisture. So you evaporate, it will cool you off, it will feel better.
You dehydrate it faster too.
Yeah, we have to keep drinking. But that's why they say dry heat is better than humid heat. If it's 85 and it's completely humid, you will overheat quickly. You might die for sunstroke, heat stroke. And it's only 85, 100% humidity. It could be 110 and completely dry and you'll survive by just drinking water. So this is the difference between very high humidity and low humidity. So people always prefer the heat of Arizona than the heat in Florida. It's really muggy and it's really hard to breathe. So that's the difference between wet heat and humid heat. And also, do you think that, that's another piece of information, would you think that wet air, like high humidity air, has more oxygen or less oxygen than dry air?
Less.
Huh?
Less.
Less oxygen. It has less oxygen because it's loaded with moisture and it displaces the oxygen. So you have less oxygen.
Trapped in the moisture.
Yeah, in a sense, and it's displaced by the moisture. It's really hard to breathe. Okay, another thing, would you think high humidity air is lighter or heavier than dry air?
Heavier.
Huh?
Heavier.
Are you sure?
Oh no, it's actually lighter. The air itself is lighter.
Humid air is lighter than pure air. That's a really kind of counterintuitive factor. And why is that? It's because the water vapor molecule, is actually lighter than the oxygen molecule. So I don't know how is this useful, but I'm just telling you. It's not useful what we're doing. This is information. This is the cooling load, and this is, again, it's from 97, so that's like 20 years ago. So I don't think the image, probably as a rate, it's still the same, but it increased significantly. Probably you can go to the Department of Energy website and find more information about the consumption. This is actually a very good schematics, and it shows you where the sun is hitting the house, and it explains to you why we always want to have windows in the, or shades in the east and south. West. This east or west? It says west. So this is
that's west.
Yeah, the location of the sun and all seasons. So the south is always going to be sunny. So if you want to have windows to the south, we also want to have some tree shades. So you have windows, but you also want shades to be in the south because the air is always going to be sunny. The west side, east also is the location that's always going to be exposed to the sun, and you keep it unexposed because you want to start heating your house in the morning. It's really cold, and that will subsidize your your heating bill. So you keep that for the morning time to heat up. And same way in the summertime, when it, in the morning it's going to be very cold. So for the first few hours you can equalize the heat. And the west, that's coming closer tonight when you want things to be cooler, so you shade that. And the placement of the trees is also done strategically, so you will not have the trees too close to your house, and you want some tall trees that do not obstruct the view, and also in case there's a storm, it will not fall and break your house. And Tom probably will have a lot of information about that. What kind of trees do you want around your house, and how much do you want to clear around your house for this case? They were saying in California, because there is a lot of wildfires, wherever you live, you should clear out the area. And just if you clear the area efficiently, even if there's a wildfire, your house will be safe. So you should put some money into cleaning the area. And that's also one of the issues is human have been living in places where they're not supposed to be. So this area is always getting some fires, wildfires. It's part of the nature cycle. So you go in there, you intrude, and you didn't do the proper adjustment, and this is what happens. Like you caught in the middle of the fire, which is a natural cycle. And they said in the last 15 years, that was actually in NPR, they were saying that we were interfering with wildfires for like the last 10 years by killing grass or trying to prevent it. And now when that actually happens, it's going to be 10 times stronger than it used to. Because there's a lot of things to feed the fire. So, think about where you build your house. I never got the idea why do people build their house in a flood places. Like this place is prone to floods, but then somebody was talking about it because they are cheaper. You can buy a place in a house for like really less than $50,000. But you know, when you pay that money, that this house is prone to flood. It's gonna flood. So now the government is trying to buy out those houses. Like, okay, you're gonna be flooded soon, and we're gonna have to go and rescue and. You might lose your life, and so we're gonna buy this house from you. However, with the amount of money they're getting, they cannot buy a different house. Yeah. So that's why they just bite the bullet and live in a place where it's prone to fire.
Build a trench around your house.
Huh?
Just dig a trench.
It's not even one house, it's plenty of houses. So it's a confidence for people living there. And also I think in terms of flood, they are trying to like retreat a little bit with the trend of rising sea level. It's going to happen eventually, so you might want to retreat a little bit. And there's a lot of inland spaces that are free. So it's something to think about. Summer heat, it's air temperature that makes you feel hot. That's sensible heat, right? Then we have radiant temperature, which is the sun rays hitting your body, and the UV cooking you slowly, and the humidity. The humidity makes it uncomfortable, it makes it harder to breathe, and it also prevents you from evaporating your sweat. So you're not going to be able to regulate your body temperature using sweat and the air movement. Uh-huh. If there is no air, if it's humid and it's hot and there's no wind at all, no breeze, what's happening? Let's look at this picture. So your body is having three modes heat transfer at the same time. Your body is radiating, your body is doing conduction, it's also doing convection. And we said air can be sticky. Actually, air is sticky, every fluid is sticky. So you have a film around you that's completely hot. If there is no air to push that film away from you, you're going to maintain that film of air around your body and you're going to be hot. That's why if you have a breeze, the breeze will help move the heat, scrape the heat out of your body and move away. So radiation is there, and you have the evaporation, so around you there's an aura or like a halo of hot air and humidity that's sitting there. And convection, the hot air is coming out, but it's a natural convection, so if you're not moving, it's probably going to be hotter. That's why when you see people running in the summertime, if you're running in the heat, it's not that bad, because at least you're losing heat as you run. And what would the conduction be? It's a very small amount, probably through the shoes on the bottom.
Sandals.
Yeah. So this is the combination of heats you have in the summer. And it's very, I don't know, I find it very uncomfortable to be in hot climate than to be in cold climate, because in cold climate you can easily put stuff on.
Yeah, you can't take stuff.
What are you gonna do?
Yeah.
Stripped bare, bare metal, then what? It's nothing. That's why people rely on being in the water, having swimming pools, because the temperature of the water usually never gets above 80, 75, 78, so it's always going to be cool. It takes a lot of energy and sun rays to heat the water. So if it's really hot, if you're really hot, you're gonna just go sit in the water all day. Heat gain. These are the four types of heat gain we have in a residential house. So we have solar heat. Sun is heating the material through radiation, hitting your roof, hitting your walls. They're going to be hot. That's radiation hitting the walls. It's heating the outer layer of the wall. The conduction will carry the stuff through the material. So what type of material you have in the middle also matters. Internal heat, things that are producing heat. Now they matter. We said that lighting and equipment, appliances, number of people add heat. We do not count that for heating load, but we count that for cooling load, because it's working against you. So your fridge is making heat, your TV is making a lot of heat, especially the old ones. Your computer has a lot of heat. Ovens, lights, if you don't have LEDs, if you have incandescent lights, you'll feel the heat coming to you. So you have to work on that. Air leakage, which is infiltration. So your house is, with cold air, is it going to be high pressure or low pressure compared to the outside? If the outside is hot and inside is cold.
Low.
Inside is going to be high pressure because the cold air is heavier, right?
Oh, yeah.
So it's heavier, it wants to leak out. So air leakage will work against you again because you're going to this place.
Especially cold air, from outlets.
Yeah. Hot airs and cold airs. From outlets, from the connection between the walls, door strips, there will always be a lot of cold air. Then we have transmission heat through the walls. The inside of the walls will be cold, the outside is very hot, so the heat will transmit from the outside to the inside. Okay? So heat gain components. Solar heat gain from windows between 15 and 35. So windows play a major role into getting heat inside your house. Roof, 10 to 30%. That's why you want to put a lot of insulation. Walls, 3 to 8%. Because again, let's think about it. Walls usually a bright color, and you're only heating the outer shell using radiation. And what is the temperature difference between outside and inside? What is the hottest day here?
95? Yeah,
100, 105. What's inside? 75?
20 degrees.
20, 30 degrees, that's not bad. It's not as bad as the summertime when you have to heat from zero all the way to 75. So it's half.
Wintertime, you mean?
Huh?
From the wintertime,
yeah.
You mean?
So the temperature is not that bad. So most of the heat coming from the sun by heating the first layer. So heat gain from the walls not that bad. But internal heat gain, 10 to 15%, that's going to be you and the equipment. And humidity, that's another issue for humidity. Hot air tends to be able to carry more moisture with it. Air leakage, 10 to 20%. Air leakage humidity, because you are replacing dry air, dehumidified air with humid air. So that's added to your cooling load. That's why when you do refrigeration and you have to size an AC, you have to account for psychometrics, which is the amount of heat and dew point. And that load will add your AC power, a lot of making water. And the difference between indoor and outdoor, how it differs from one day to another, that's also another factor. Okay, I'll stop here and finish the rest on Friday. If not, I'll finish it on Monday. Thank you.